Bé, doncs comencem aquesta tercera sessió del programa d'aquest any sobre l'organització i govern de la ciència i la tecnologia. I avui tenim com a tema com podem ser més europeus en ciència. Sempre ens ha preocupat que Europa sigui Europa, no un grup de nacions, sinó un país i tenir entitat pròpia. Doncs et sembla que avui tenim una mica l'oportunitat de veure una visió des d'Europa amb algú que està molt ficat en temes relacionats amb associacions grans i que ens pugui donar aquesta visió, no? Des de, com a Europa com a unitat. Ara el Jaume Miranda ens presentarà a l'Elisabet Lipiatov, que és qui avui ens parlarà. Moltes gràcies.
Bona tarda. Today we have an European voice. His lecture will be about how we can be more European in science and technology, which is the lemma of this conference. In terms of the organization and governance of science, Europe is our natural field of action. Its criteria are our guides in many aspects, following its strategic and tactical criteria, are part also of our legality and our financing. As you can see in the summary of the conference, our guest today, Dr. Elisabet Lipiatow, will speak to us as a very expert in European policies, especially as officer of the Directorate General of Communication Networks, Contents and Technology. Dr. Lipiatow has also a broad academic curricula in Europe and USA, of which they have a sample in the program of the cycle of conference, which you can dispose in our web, especially specialized in the field of marine sciences and a strategy for sustainable development. And as regards of the motto of our cycle, Dr. Lipiatow has more than 23 years of experience in managing the research and policy interfaces. Let me remind to the audience that they can use the question and answers at any time to ask their questions. Now, Dr. Lipiatow, our screen is yours. Thank you for your contribution.
I am a chemist. I have a PhD in marine science. And before I joined the commission, something like 25 years ago, I, as it was said, I had in several years an important scientific and research experience. This is, if I have to say, the puzzle of my European, but not only life. I start from Athens to go to Paris, then to go to Barcelona, then to Minneapolis to conclude in Brussels. So I am a convinced European, and I should say that Barcelona has a very special place in my heart because I was in your beautiful city from 90 to 92 as a Marie Curie fellow, a postdoc, amongst the first European postdocs in the Centro de Investigación en Desarrollo in Barcelona. And I, from this time, I keep a very special memory. It was a wonderful time, both scientifically, but also personally. And I used to speak, I learned Spanish. I used also to understand, speak a little bit Catalan, but after so many years, I lost these skills. So today I will address to you in English, of course. So as it was said also, I had 25 years of experience in the European Commission. And I managed marine research on sustainable development, and then climate change, international cooperation, migration, and lately I'm working on DigiConnect, where I deal with digital transformation. I am head of unit and for many years, and in all of this itinerary, I had the chance to, in different initiatives, to collaborate with very fine scientists from your country and your city. So I know Mikkel Hanars for the many years. It was from the period I managed the Mediterranean Marine Research. And it was certainly a very big pleasure and honor to be invited by him to join you here today. So I'm this is a presentation. I don't make it. I'm, of course, above all an EU official, but it is more like someone who did the itinerary I told you. And of course, I will focus on European issues, but it are also my views on what I am telling. So this is actually why there is a disclaimer at the first slide of my presentation. My views engage me and not the European Commission. So I guess let's start that most of us agree that we live on special times where change is accelerating and complexity as well. So we live in a world that is getting warmer. We experience COVID-19 pandemic since 1 year. And we are also experiencing rapid digital transformation. So in this context, I am sure we all agree that there is no nation, no country, not even group of countries can tackle all of these challenges alone. So we need to work together internationally. And one of the common languages that many nations, many countries, many group of countries are talking is science. So science is important, is a common language, but it's also important because there is a very important scientific background to all of this. And science has a special role to play in working with climate change, in dealing with health crises like COVID-19, and also accompany us in digital transformation. So this is, will be the focus, therefore, and of course, what Europe is doing and what are the European programs. I will also move from science to application of science towards the end of my presentation. So I thought to start from the first challenge, then it is the warming world. And then you see here the, I choose to show these changes in global temperature from the 90s to 2000s. And you could see how much fast are warming some parts of our planet. You could also see a blue spot on the north, and it indicates the melting of the Greenland ice. So I thought then, since we speak about this, to show you this slide, then when you can see the changes in the Arctic Ocean sea ice from 84 to 2010 plus. And you could see that indeed there are scientific data that show that the waters in the Arctic Ocean and in the atmosphere, the temperature are warming 5 times faster than anywhere else in the planet. So I also thought that it will be important to start focusing a bit in Europe and then to see that science shows us that there are important changes in precipitation from the 1960s where I'm born until now, so in lifetime. And you could see it from the left to right. So with, I thought also again with focus on Europe, what science show us that the area around the Mediterranean, so in North Africa, Middle East, also for South Europe, are among the areas that they are the most water stressed, and they are forecast to be even more, that in comparison with other parts of the planet. So I know I didn't need to convince you on this, but I thought it will be important to start with our first challenge, to go to the second, then it is COVID-19. And here to come with a question, if this crisis will live now, it is doesn't provide maybe the missing urgency for all of us to deal with climate change and the climate change impact related efforts. And of course, if COVID-19 also played an important role in accelerating digital transformation, so played like a catalyzer role. And then it leads me to the digital transformation. What is the one of the actually two important challenges in which I will focus. I will focus on the most green environmental part, climate thing, and then on the digital one. And I will try to link them. And I will try to link them focusing in Europe, in European programs and European policies. So then I come, as I come into the digital transformation, then I will say that it is clear that all of us, we're experiencing the digital transformation of the economy and on the society, that it has started, is global, it's accelerating, and it will be even doing more so in the years to come. There are this transformation results in important changes in all sectors of the economy, and also more generally in the organization of the society. We experience the impact of artificial, and we'll do even more of artificial intelligence. We feel the need for security and trust, and also the need to adopt clean and sustainable technologies. So we need to do all of this and still be faithful to European values. And in doing so, I think we could, on this basis, to have a successful digital transformation, which it will help us to keep the values we have, the European values for our society, help the environment, and help the economy. So, keeping all of this together, it will help to tackle major societal challenges, improve our competitiveness, creating jobs, and also increase the quality of public services and sustain prosperity. So everything it is linked. And as I said previously, the scientific dimension of this, all of those global challenges is important. And so is important maybe diplomacy coming with science, what we call science diplomacy. So the way to communicate and to work together to address these challenges. So science and, is helping to build bridges between different parts of this world, between the technology with innovation practices, above national interest and overall the different challenges we have to face. So which are in this context the Commission priorities? There are six, but I will focus in the two first, the European Green Deal and the Europe Fit for the Digital Age. And I will argue, and this is what it is said in many context, and it is one in a generation opportunity to ensure that Europe leads the way in between ecological and digital transition. So I will start with the European Green Deal, and then you will see that the aim of this one, as we see in the slide, is to transform the EU economy for a sustainable future. The European Green Deal increased the EU climate ambition for 2030 and 2050. So it means for 2030, we aim to cut by 55% greenhouse gas emissions, and by 2050, Europe to be the first climate neutral continent. European Green Deal also has the ambition of zero pollution for a toxic-free environment, amongst others, and also mobilizing industry for a clean and circular economy, and also the initiative from farm to fork to aim to a fair, healthy, and environmental friendly food system. So, which are the EU investment and the EU programs in this context is, of course, Horizon Europe on research and innovation, a new program named Digital Europe, which supports deployment. And I will mention here three others, although I will not focus on them in this presentation. The Connected Europe Facility, which is focused on development of infrastructures. The next, the Generation EU, the Recovery and Resilience Facility, and the Invest EU on investment support. If I show them, is because often, if we are used scientists or researchers, people from the academia work on with one program, let's say the framework program, and in this case, it will be the Horizon Europe. We do not look to other programs. And this new multi-annual framework of the new, sorry. So this new cycle of programs gives a unique opportunity to connect and to work on many of them, because they have many linked priorities, and because there is opportunities for synergies between these different programs. So as I will go on looking to Horizon Europe and Digital Europe, the idea is to look to the green, both green and digital transition using these programs, and also show their linkage they have. So which are the, beside the European Green Deal, the European policies in this context? It is the European Digital Strategy, then it has been published on February 2020, where you find inside initiatives like the Sustainable Data Centers and a circular electronics initiative. There is another policy, the European Strategy on Data, also published last year. And again, inside, you will find a common European Green Deal data space. There is also the Circular Economy Action Plan, also published in 2020, and where you find inside the regulatory measures for mobiles and printers and consumables, and also the right, what we say, to repair. So as you see, green and digital transition is linked also in terms of policies and in terms of programs. So if we take, for instance, Horizon Europe program, which actually starting this year,
Uh, We lose your voice. Yeah, we lose your voice.
Could you hear me now?
Yes, yes, now yes.
It says my internet connection is unstable. Okay, so I trust you hear me, and here it is, and that you see the slides. So this is the structure of Horizon Europe. My intention is not to present that in details. I'm sure those of you interested, you saw it, and it is a program under preparation for a number of years. I would like only to underline under the cluster 4, then it is on digital industry and space, 5 on climate, energy, and mobility, and 6 on food, bioeconomy, natural resources, agriculture, and the environment. Then they are the most focused on this double transition on the green and, as we say, digital one. So what are the objectives? The key objectives for Horizon Europe is tackling climate change, helping achieving sustainable development goals, boosting the union's competitiveness and growth. Again, you can see the double objective. So one of the also new novelties, if you like, of Horizon Europe is the missions. The missions aim to link along a very important objective, bring close science to society and have also and take into account citizen needs. So if you see which are these, there are 5 missions, and those are adaptation to climate change, including societal transformation, cancer, healthy oceans, seas, coastal, and inland waters, climate neutral and smart cities, soil health, and food. You could see the impact of the green transition, what we call it. So you see the importance of the changing environment in those 5 missions, and you see the potential for digital transformation and the impact of digital transformation on those 5 missions. And we will come back to it. So I spoke before on one of the cluster of Horizon Europe, the digital industry in space, and then you could see that inside the impact is on for Europe to have global leadership in clean and climate neutral industrial value chains, circular economy, and climate neutral digital systems and infrastructures. You see again the link in which I focus in this presentation. I don't know if you see all of the slide or a part of it is covered as it is covered on my screen.
Now it's only covered the top and the bottoms, but the contents is well seen.
Okay, I cannot do anything better at this moment, so I have to. Okay. So it is a. I don't know if I can move this. I think it's better like this, correct?
Now find that. Yeah. Now we only have a line at the bottom, but this is not occluding.
Yeah, I think it's not
occluding anything. So now we see the title, Green Digital Transition. Yeah.
So I think it is a bit better, let's say.
Yes, it's better.
Okay. So then again to the Green Digital Transition and relevant EU policies, the objectives of shaping Europe's digital future, European strategy on data, circular economy, and SME strategy are key objectives and accompanied by relevant and recent, very recent EU policies. So now I will go from there to more digital technologies, so information and communication technologies. And I will try to examine them from their environmental impact point of view. What is the environmental footprint of ICT? So this is something discussed often. Here I thought some data are of interest. So it is found that 8 to 10% of the electricity consumption, it is done by the ICT, by the information communication technologies, and 2 to 4% of the carbon emissions. So all around data, all around the world, are set by 2025 to account that as much greenhouse gas emissions as all air traffic. There is also substantial electronic waste. Also, the mobile phones we all have is produced by 60 different metals, from which only 20 can be recycled. And finally, I am sure you observed that the life of digital devices from 85 to now decreased from 11 to only 4 years. So there is an important environmental footprint, therefore, from these technologies. At the same time, this important environmental footprint provides for an opportunity to improve energy and material efficiency for ICT. So this, what is a fact, to be, it is to become like an objective, like a target for improvement. And that is what the different programs will give the opportunity to do, and go for energy efficiency of data centers, improve lifespan of electronic equipment, to have a more transparency on the foot, of the carbon footprint of the ICT infrastructure, and also work on eco-labeling and green public procurement. So, and then use these technologies for helping the environment and helping deal with climate change. So these technologies, they have the potential to reduce by 20% total greenhouse gas emissions, what it is almost 10 times more than their own footprint. So, and how? Because they, through the digitalization for energy grids, precision farming, climate smart cities and communities, smart mobility, sustainable manufacturing and waste treatment, and by forecasting more accurately extreme weather events and climate impact, and through more accurate and powerful modeling. So then it gives me the entry to this new program that is we have for the first time in Europe, and this is the Digital Euro Program. It will have its first call for proposals in May this year, and it has as main objectives to compete globally with digital technologies, to achieve scale through collective investments along these technologies when one country cannot do alone, to gain control or regain control on Europe's value chains, and better address overall economic and societal European challenges and support small, medium enterprises. So this is the structure of the program. So you see, quite different from Horizon Europe. Still, there are a lot of synergies between the two programs. So it is has the first specific objective is the high performance computing. The second is artificial intelligence, cybersecurity, advanced digital skills. And the program, it will has, as you see, some vertical objectives, what it is, and finance, European digital innovation hubs, and high impact deployment. From all of this, I will stay in the advanced digital skills, and I may believe it's of special importance for you, that you say that, of course, there are other programs than the big programs like Erasmus, etc., and they work with skills. But Digital Euro Program will provide financing for advanced digital skills. How? By giving providing opportunities to design of specialized programs and modules in key capacity areas of those I just mentioned, like artificial intelligence, high performance computing, etc. So specifically European master classes on those areas. And also give possibilities for other schemes to develop what we need in Europe, advanced digital skills. Another part of the program that also I would like to highlight is the European Digital Innovation Hubs. They will be at least one of them per European region. Actually, we believe it will be around 200 coming out of our first call for proposals. They will build on existing digital innovation hubs. And as you see, their name now is European Digital Innovation Hub, so which will upgrade digital innovation hubs where they exist or create where they don't, help with the aim to help SMEs to become more digital. So they will be hubs which companies could test technologies before invest. They will help with developing, with training and skills development, and will of course support and create innovation ecosystems. So what can I do with this? And of course, networking. So inside the Digital Europe program, they will be initiative and project which will contribute to sustainable developments and to the Green Deal. Again, you see the link. It will be by, and the program will do it by supplying clean, affordable, and secure energy, mobilizing industry for clean and circular economy, building and renovating in energy and resource efficiency, accelerating the shift to sustainable and smart mobility, and also contributing with precise precision agriculture from to the initiative from farm to fork. Maybe I would like to highlight one special feature of this program. It is a specific article in this regulation, which will give the possibility for some of the specific objectives to restrict the participation of entities established outside the EU or established in the EU but controlled by third countries in specific areas. Because the aim of the program is to build European strength, European sovereignty in digital technologies, and in some of them it will be necessary to restrict participation to European actors, European companies. Of course, this type of restrictions needs justification, and it will be activated in case by case topics. So, and that it brings me to this, that of course, the idea is that to recognize that also development, fast development of digital technologies and infrastructures gives opportunities, but at the same time creates new dependencies and vulnerabilities across the economy and the society. Often we spoke about, for instance, cyber attacks amongst others. And that means that it is necessary for Europe to master digital technologies, to be sovereign in some of this, in order to make sure that in a secure way we address the challenges, both the digital and the green challenges in front of us. So this is why there is the possibility in the Digital Euro programs when necessary to focus in Europe and exclude actors from outside. So to make, therefore, the digital transformation a success, we will focus on AI, we will focus on security and trust, we will focus on sustainability through the multiple European programs. And for this, just this week, the European Commission presented a vision and avenues for Europe's digital transformation, also by 2030, which you see is a target year both for the Green Deal and also for the digital transformation, so what we call it is the Europe's digital decade. So, and with this, I think I will close my presentation. I would like to thank you very much for the invitation and the attention, and I will be happy to reply to any question.
Thank you very much for your presentation, Dr. Lydia Tou. I have a question from Mr. Canals, Dr. Canals. What an European region as Catalonia, which you know very well, could do the best in practical terms to attract talent scientists from other all other countries of the world? In other words, which policy initiatives and incentives will you suggest?
Well, first of all, I think Barcelona and Catalonia was rather successful in attracting scientists, certainly from Europe. So I think one of the, I don't want to discuss here. I mean, I am sure that you know the opportunities and possibilities provided by the Erasmus program, so I don't want to detail on this, but I would like to highlight something I mentioned, and it is this creation of hubs, of European digital innovation hubs, which it will be supported by Digital Europe, and it will be, the idea is to have one by region, so to cover all Europe, the different regions will not be in competition between themselves, and it will provide a possibility to help small medium enterprises. Also, will provide possibility to attract, I believe, young researchers to this specific region. So I think this is one of the opportunities provided by the new program for that, and it could be used by the region and the city. That is one thing. The other thing is Horizon Europe with the missions. It will provide means to connect scientists and citizens around the objective of the mission. From what I know, Barcelona and Catalonia are pretty active in the areas of the missions. And I know also that they were very active to link science and society. So I think this is another opportunity to take advantage of the new programs and to attract young scientists from all around Europe. I don't know if this is what Mikel would like from me, but I think these are two specific examples. Besides the opportunities given by Erasmus, I would like to mention them.
Thank you. Waiting for some questions from the audience. Let me another bridge question. We, as Europeans, we invented the typography in the Latin alphabet, not in the Greek alphabet, but also in the Latin alphabet. Bodoni, Italian, is an example, which every people use some typefaces in word processors invented in California. Also, with equations created in Europe, the Bézier curves, invented in France. For when an European word processor, that's only just an example, we are losing the race of the software in general. 90% perhaps, I don't know exactly. And the question is, for when a common digital policy, which is part of the responsibility, I suppose, of your general directorate. You have any ideas about in order to generate a hope for us?
Actually, I think I had a couple of slides in which they underline, I think, important policies in this general area, which I believe will play an important role, because it is clear that we need to advance, we need to make sure that regain the time we lost in this race of digitalization and digital technologies. Actually, in the last slide of my presentation, I spoke about the vision of Europe for the future, for the decade 21-30. This communication, it will soon be in consultation in all member states. I think it will be important to contribute with ideas to this, because this is why it is felt that we need an all-encompassing policy to be launched in Europe. I think you will have the opportunity through not only through the different program committees, so through your representatives in the work of the different programs, but also through the open consultation to society to come with ideas for this very critical decade that we have in front of us.
I wanted to ask, I've been surprised with the level of carbonization of this digital compared to aviation and so. Of course, from the point of view of research, we have to do a lot to decrease these emissions and also the footprint that we leave with materials, etc. But maybe there is another aspect that is not directly research. And the question is how you see that from the research community and mainly from the offices in Brussels, we can influence in policy, because, for example, we define standards. And some years ago, I heard that all the phones have to be the same connector. But at the end, this doesn't happen. And you always I have many connectors of my PC. And when I change, I have to drop off all of them. So is easier things than research are not done, then we do a lot of efforts, put a lot of money in improving aspects, and then something that should be very easy, like a law that oblige all the companies to follow them, and this doesn't happen. Can we do the research community, the research body in Europe, have an influence in policies of this kind?
Yes, actually what you say is absolutely logical. I think it is, you speak, I mean, as some, I mean, you don't need to know a lot about research to say that it's something with e-waste. We really, I mean, the fact also that the time life of a cell phone decreased from 11 years to 4, it says something. That means we need to continuously change. So this is why there is now, this is why there is this attempt to speak about a twin transition. We cannot only speak about how we will improve technologies, make them more secure. So we cannot only speak about the digital transformation we need to do, but we need also to put it together with the green transformation, if you like, the objectives of green there in Europe. So this twin transition gives unique opportunities, because to reduce waste, it is an important objective of the Green Deal, and it is, of course, putting it together with the digital transformation becomes an objective also for the digital part and the digital programs. So I think is important through the participation that you have as a university, as a represented as a member state, and also as a possibility you have as society to, in consultation of different policy documents, to contribute, to request that, because at the very end, what we know, policies are there as a reply to what the society needs. So in some ways, what I try to do in this presentation, and I know it, and it is not easy, because generally even the Commission and in Europe, either we speak about the green part or we speak about the digital one. Try to speak about both is not easy. And also I found out when I was trying to put together the slides, it was not straightforward, because I could find things only for the environmental part or only for the digital part. But to construct things for the both, it was not easy, and it says something. And this is the reply to your question, because we cannot speak only for the environment without thinking the other part. We cannot speak only for the need to run on the digital arena, if you like, without thinking of the environment. So we had a commissioner which, anyway, now it works quite a lot in a past one on these double objectives. And often he says that this is the opportunity we have now to work on both, and one to benefit the other.
Thank you.
I tell you, really, in putting together what I present to you, I also realize that we need to do, in all instances, quite a lot of work to link them.
Thank you.
We have a question from the Professor Angel Massagué. Thank you for your presentation. It is fascinating to look at so many plans for the forthcoming years. However, the European Union has all those plans, and suddenly emerges a pandemic situation. A situation that as citizens we have lacked from a united safety regulations to be protected from these pandemics. In addition, the question of lacking of enough vaccines has also been a matter of high concern for all of us. In resume, what has the Union learned from the pandemic and the opportunity of being more active and united for the next future? We can trust in all the plans that you have presented just viewing what has happened with the COVID-19 at the European level. Thank you very much in advance. It's not easy question.
well, it's not easy. However, thank you for the question. I fully understand the question. I'm also a European citizen above all, but I am also an employee of the European Commission. The question, it goes from, it touches many things, including policies and politics. And so I will not go so much on this area. What I want to say, however, is, and that is something that I am sure we all recognize. I think the research behind even the vaccines, the research, the health-related research financed by the European Union, really, I think, shows its strength and its possibilities. So I know that this is not enough. And then from research results to application of the research results and what it goes after, there are many blocks. I don't want to comment on how crisis management and all of this. I think it is not, I'm not the expert on this, and I think it will not be correct to do it. I can do it outside this context, in a group of friends and colleagues, but not right now. I also, there is something I do believe, and I think I should say it, is no matter what is the situation, I think in Europe, being research, being deployment of research results, we are stronger when we are all together. That I really believe it. So we have to learn from this crisis. We need to learn as individuals, as regions, as countries, and as the Union all together. And to be stronger for the next time we have to face these challenges, that is clear. But I think there is no doubt on what we mostly discussed today, on research, on innovation, on deployment of digital technologies. Europe, as Europeans, when we are together, we are stronger. That's what I can reply. And I know I don't reply fully to the question. I just give some elements of reply.
Thank you. I think there are no more questions from our audience. Perhaps our president, Professor Canals, can close the conference. In any case, thank you, Dr. Lipiatou.
Okay. Thank you very much. It's very good to have this view from one who is in the heart of Europe and trying and communicating and with everybody. And I think it has been very enriching for all of us. And so we appreciate very much your presentation and posterior debate, and to enrich our program of conferences this year on this kind of research and government and management of the research in Europe, in Catalonia, and everywhere. Okay.
Thank you very much for the invitation. I'm looking forward to meet you in another opportunity physically. So I think when we will be out of all of this, and I hope that all of you will take advantage of all new programs that they will now open actually this year with calls for proposals and new opportunities.
Okay, thank you very much. And hope, yes, to have in a live presence next time.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
I gràcies a tots els que heu participat en aquesta sessió i esperem que participeu també el mes que ve.